স্যার, তাহলে শুরু করছি স্যার।
হ্যাঁ
তো গুড আফটারনুন এভরিবডি, আই ওয়েলকাম ইউ অল টু দিস থার্ড, দিস ইজ টেকনিক্যালি দ্য থার্ড লেকচার আন্ডার দ্য সিরিজ অফ বিশ্বভারতী ইয়াং স্কলার্স লেকচার সিরিজ, বাট টুডেজ ইজ আ স্পেশাল লেকচার। উই আর ভেরি হ্যাপি দ্যাট উই হ্যাভ ডক্টর সূর্য শাইকিয়া অ্যামাং আস হু ইজ গোয়িং টু ডেলিভার দিস লেকচার টুডে, আ লেকচার উইচ ইজ ভেরি পার্টিনেন্ট। বাট বিফোর উই স্টার্ট, মে আই রিকোয়েস্ট স্যার আওয়ার অনারেবল ভাইস চ্যান্সেলার টু অ্যাড্রেস টু সে আ ফিউ ওয়ার্ডস টু আস।
Yeah, thank you, Bipasha. First of all, I, make it very clear that those who are participants here are all honorable. So I'm not the honorable person here. I think everybody is honorable. So I think next time, Bipasha, either you abdicate this particular word or use this with regard to everybody who are participating in this discussion. And secondly, I'm wondering whether a scholar can be young or old, because if you believe in Einstein's famous statement or Tagore's famous statement that even at the fag end of his life, almost life, he made a statement that I am just collecting the pebbles in the ocean of knowledge. So scholars continue to remain young. So I think, probably young you use in the chronological sense. Surjo is younger than me, so he is young scholars. But scholars cannot be young. Scholars do not have any age, I guess. Anyway, I am very happy and privileged to be able to speak a few words on this occasion. And as I keep saying, it was actually your initiative which made this possible. We just, discussed this particular issue, and it came during the discussion that we should start this kind of lecture series for the quote-unquote young scholars to place their point of view before us or exchange ideas with other quote-unquote young scholars. And I'm very happy that Surjo has taken up the challenge to take up a topic which is very close to my heart, that is about higher education. Because I think, we need to ask this question to ourselves, whether we are being educated or we are being learned. Because, I think I make a distinction. You may have formal degrees with good, grades, but that doesn't mean you are really learning. So I think learning is something which is different from education. So, and if you look at the national education policy, and those who are really experts in education, including Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, they always insisted on quality learning. And that for quality learning, you need to get out of the formal classroom, formal syllabus, and would like to use your knowledge, your capability of comprehension to understand the world around you. So I think education, comprehension of the world, then it makes no sense. It's futile as far as I'm concerned. So I'm really quite excited, to listen to Surjo, because, I'm a little fossilized in terms of my ideas. But Surjo, with a kind of a fresh mind, probably will enlighten me and would help me understand this complex question or the complex distinction between education and learning. And I'm sure, Surjo will say things on the basis of his experience as a teacher, both here and in Assam. I think Silchar, right? You are from Silchar, Surjo?
Sir, from Assam.
Assam, yes, Assam. So I think with your kind of in a varied experience from Assam and also from Bengal, you'll be able to enlighten us. Now, with these few words, I compliment Bipasha for having been able to carry this forward. And I was very happy when I listened to her that many of our younger scholars are interested to place their point of view for public consumption. So I'm sure with Bipasha's able and competent leadership, this particular lecture series will survive and will also excel in course of time. And needless to say, as the member of this family, I'm very happy, and whatever help I can extend, I'll be there to do that. With these few words, I wish you all the best, and I am really looking forward to this exciting lecture by Surjo. Surjo, all the best, and over to you, Bipasha.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for those kind words. My committee members will be very happy with all the encouragement. We are going to start this lecture. This, as I said, is a very special lecture. May I now request Dr. Shubhashree Shannal to introduce Dr. Saikia and to start the proceedings. Shubhashree, welcome, and over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. Initially, I would like to introduce Dr. Saikia, and before that, I would like to say a few words about the lecture today. It's a special lecture in the sense that it is a lecture across the disciplines. This is necessary for all of us who are working here, depending on whatever capacity and whichever stream that we are working on. So at present, the pedagogical understanding in quality of higher education is imperative. Since it has become an essential part of the progress report of any universities, we have the NAAC, we have the AISHE, and various assessment parameters which continuously question us on the quality of higher education. And without assessing the quality of education we are imparting at the university, it is truly difficult to understand how are we performing and where we are going. The present topic, therefore, I believe would be a testimony in fathoming the concept of qualities necessary for higher education. Now talking about Dr. Saikia, Dr. Saikia, Surjo Kumar Saikia is currently working as assistant professor in Department of Zoology, Vishwabharati, and he's a postgraduate from Cotton College, Guwahati, Assam in 2000, and completed his PhD in 2006 from Rajiv Gandhi University, Itanagar, Arunachal Pradesh. He has also completed his B.Ed. from Dibrugarh University in 2001. He teaches biodiversity, biostatistics, systemics, taxonomy, animal behavior, and basic ecology to graduate and postgraduate students. A total of 6 research projects credited to him from different funding agencies, of which 4 has already been successfully completed and 2 projects are still going on. His field of research is aquatic ecology and fish biology, especially on morphoecology and feeding ecology, fish sensory biology, and oxidative stress. A total of 50 research publications in different national and international refereed journals are credited in his name. He also authored 3 books on scientific discipline, namely Laboratory Handbook on Basic Ecology in Writing Science Research Papers, Step-to-Step Approach, Student Book on Organic Evolution, Systematics, and Taxonomy. He successfully supervised 4 PhD students and is now supervising 4 more. His passion of writing extends beyond academic arena and enters in writing short stories, articles, and poems in print media. His upcoming poetry book is No Goodbye to You. He also has a passion in playing with the brush and colors during his recreational time. And personally, I would vouch for it because Shujada is an amazing painter. So I welcome my very dear colleague, Dr. Surjo Kumar Saikia, to deliver his lecture. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Shubhashree.
Thank you, Shubhashree. So, before this nice introduction, is it visible to all of you?
Yes, yes, Sujata, you may proceed.
Okay. So, good afternoon to all of you. Before going to start my talk, I'd like to thank the organizers, the Young Scholars Lecture Series, for giving me this opportunity to address this August gathering. And this topic is not directly related to my research work, but even though as a special lecture, they have given this opportunity to me, and for that also I thank you to them. So my topic is, what means quality in higher education? As you know, nowadays governments are emphasizing more on quality in higher education. Our new education policy is one of such efforts. So in this topic, I will cover 3 three chapters. One is that understanding quality. What qualities we'll try to understand in terms of higher education. And also benchmarking, that is also with an example from NIRF ranking of Vishwabharati, we'll try to understand how benchmarking helps us to improve our quality. Then world ranking impact. There are many world ranking agencies, how their ranking impact us on the quality improvement. So these three chapters we will try to cover in this short presentation. So let me give you one small introduction of what is the situation. In 2011, there is a book published in 2012 by the name is Making a Difference. This book is on Australian education system. As you know, for your reference, I would like to share that Australian education system is one of the best education system. And here, one author, Goddard B., he predicted that by 2025, the overall total student population for higher education will be around 262 million. And surprisingly, most of this pool of the students will be from India and China. Similarly, he also predicted that by 2025, the international pool of students will be around 8 million. So these 8 million, out of these 8 million, also maximum, the major part of the students will be contributed from India and China. And later, UNESCO Institute of Statistics, this has proved the prediction of Goddard. You can see the graph here. This is from 2099.92, around, you can see 250.7 million in number by 2020. And from that onwards, it is steeply increasing up to five, this prediction is there to increase up to 594.1 million by 2040. This is really an alarming situation because the number is increasing, so we have to improve the quality. There's a pressure on higher education institutes. And on the right side, if you see, the US in 2018-19, there was a survey on international students studying in US. The survey also reflected the same thing that in US, the maximum, the number of students, major part are from China and India. You can see the graph on the right corner, China and India. So these from the third world countries, it is really a challenging situation because they cannot accommodate a number of students, this is rising students in their high institutes. As a result, the good students are going out of the country. The third world countries, they suffer from two challenges in general. One is the globalization and second is internationalization. These two words are interchangeably used in many a times. They are equally used by many. But there is a difference. Globalization means the economic developments, technological advancements, scientific progress, etc. at a global level. And internationalization means the policies or strategies taken up by the governments or the institute or the departments for exchange of know-how, resources between the countries. For example, if we talk about the educational institutes, these are the exchange of faculties, the students, the collaborative projects, etc. So how the curriculum of the institute, if we talk about the academic institute, how the curriculum is adjusted to see the effect of globalization and to adjust the internationalization, because we need to have curriculum to be adjusted with these two challenges, because globalization has direct impact on internationalization. So curriculum to be improved to meet the challenges of the globalization and internationalization. So far, teachers we need to have good teachers as a resource. And likewise, students also, we need to have better students in our institute. Administrators to be of having good policy makers. And similarly, infrastructure. This is also better than chalk and board method. How can we shift to interactive boards? Likewise, technology can bring into the classroom. These steps, strategies we need to adapt to upgrade ourselves at the international level. Now, the quality we will talk about, when we go for these two challenges, we have to address the quality of our institute. In 1985, Christopher Bell asked in his book, Fitness for Purpose, this is a very popular book, Essays in Higher Education. Here, Christopher Bell asked, what the hell is quality? And he replied that if I'm saying that my courses are having employability as outcome, how many students got placements? Do I have any count? It means quality is not a philosophical term in case of higher education. This is not just an abstract. This is a countable something, a measure which we can count the something which will give us a projection of some quality. So this means that what is quality of education means we should have something to reply. That is why if we ask what is quality in education, it is actually we are asking what is life. If there is no quality, there is no life in the education. So if we ask the question that what is quality in higher education to, for example, as an institution, we will face three challenges, because quality is a relative term. We have a number of stakeholders in our institute. Say, for example, auditors, funding agencies, teachers, the non-teaching staff, the administrators. All these stakeholders have their own set of standards and their objectives. And to pull them together and the as a whole, how to project the quality of the institute is a difficult task. So the relativism in quality is a challenge. Second is benchmarking relativism. The benchmarking relativism, benchmark means to comparison, to get something which we can compare for a better quality justification. So, but the problem is that when we talk about, say, for example, university, no two universities are similar by their mission and vision, by their programs, by their facilities, by their infrastructure. It is very difficult. So benchmark is a relative term for quality assessment. Third aspect, quality statement. It is a that what is good quality 5 years ago may not be the same today. So the quality perception is every 5 years or 2 years, 1 year, quality. So the quality, if we define, we want to define, we cannot define it in terms of some words, some definitions. We have to deliver it in practice. And whatever, we need a prescription, because even though it is difficult to define, we need something to have to compare, some substandard we need to have to compare. Some standard we need to have to compare. So desired quality, we need to have some standards. Say for example, if I'm talking about I'm healthy, means I have a set of parameters, blood pressure, temperature, sugar level. Similarly, the institute must have, the high institute must have some parameters which will be fixed for to understand the quality of the institute. If we deviate from those parameters, means we are deviating from the desirable targets. Many a times, the deviation is so much that it becomes irreversible. So there are two steps, two processes through which we can manage the quality component. One is precautionary level. Precautionary level means if we understand this is the quality of our institute, we can maintain some parameters, the parameters such in a such level that it never goes down. Or second is remedial level. Remedial, it is already, the quality is already going down, but we have to take immediate steps so that it can be recovered. Say for example, in the last 4 years, our NIRF ranking is going down. So whatever we are doing today, we are trying to recover the NIRF ranking. So this is, we are at the remedial level. Anyway, when we go for education institute, the quality has three functions, three features. Every institute has some mission and vision. The first and foremost feature we need to have to fulfill this mission and vision. Second is, as I told you earlier, that achieving predefined set of standards to benefit the stakeholders, all those stakeholders having their own standards. So how to achieve those targets? This is the second feature we need to have to achieve the quality. And third is most important. We are the public funded organization. We are accountable to the public. So in what way we successfully transform our learning experiences to the learners? That is the third point we need to achieve if we mean quality for higher education. But the question is how we need to address four corners. Here you can see there are four corners. These are the pillars of the achieving quality in an education institute. First one is that achieve purposefulness. You can see the purposefulness. Here, mission, this addresses mission and vision or the set of the standards of the stakeholders. Second is the accountability of the stakeholders as well as the society. Then it comes to transformation, where we will transform our objectives to the learners. And to achieve this, we need something which is far better, which is we consider best practices. We need to adapt. This is we can say exceptional. So this is going to become the flagship of the institute, and this will give the distinctive achievements to the institute. So let us see in an elaborative way what these four pillars cover. You can see the purposefulness when you talk about, as I told you, this fulfilling the mission and vision, then achieving the standards, and also attainment of institutional goals. We have goals as per the curriculum, as an institute, as a subject. So these goals are to be achieved. Then you come to accountability. There, the students' preparedness for employment. That is our accountability. And how to provide best quality to the students. That is another part of the accountability. Sufficiency of the facilities and a continuous improvement also a part of the accountability. Then I told you the transformative. Whatever we do in an academic institute, higher education institute, these are all should be learner-centric approach. We should have clarity in our objectives and outcomes. We should have competence in our lectures. And most importantly, we should engage the student with the contents, with the objectives and the outcomes. And when all these three pillars are running very comfortably, we can do best in these three pillars. It means we are moving towards the exceptional part, where we'll get credibility, reputation, ranking, prestige, etc. But the question is how to do this? Because as I told you, these are quality is a term which can be measured, can be counted. So we need some indicators to assess the quality. And these indicators are coming from all these pillars on three different areas, or four different areas. First one is the student support. How do we support the students? How do we support the students? Hello, am I audible? Hello?
Yes.
Oh, Sujata, the sound is breaking much.
Now it's here.
Now is it fine? Is it fine?
Yes, it's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now these indicators, you can say the first one is the student support. The student support means the fellowship, the scholarship, the counselings, career counselings. So all these components, the academic support, classroom facilities, how we are supporting the students, all these are coming to student support. Then administrative, how the administration is coordinated with the students as well as the academic family members to fulfill the objective goals of the institute. This is the administration. And third one is instruction. Means it is mainly related to curriculum, how we upgrade the curriculum to meet the demands of the time and as well as the students. Whether we are reviewing it timely or we are adopting new programs or not, all these are coming under instruction. And all these three efforts will go to the students' performance. What is their progression? What is their progression to higher education, employment? These all are coming to the student performance. So before going to the next part, I'd like to introduce here, because these indicators we're discussing, a concept which is the quality as fitness for purpose. This is a concept very popular, and it is in management studies, this concept is highly adopted. And mainly the accreditors, they see how an institute fulfill the demands as per the set standard of the institute. And that is known as quality as fitness for purpose, shortly QFP. It was popularized by one engineer come my management counselor, that is Joseph M. Juran. His popular view is that vital few and trivial many. It means 80% of the problems are coming from 20% of causes. This is very important, because all the indicators may not be equally important to achieve the quality. Few indicators may have high importance, high significance. So we need to identify those 20% of problems or the indicators from which we can extract maximum outcomes to achieve the quality. Here, the term is used performance indicator. These are called performance indicators. So what is a performance indicator then? These are the indicators, the measures, which are actually information in measurable terms. And so we can analyze, compute them in terms of four different comparisons among the fields over time and on the commonly accepted standards. And this information provide us to what degree the teaching learning quality objectives are being fulfilled by that particular institute. So accordingly, we can take initiatives from the poor to fair, fair to good, good to great. These indicators can help us. How can help us the performance indicators? It helps us to monitor our own performances in terms of comparative purposes. This is very important, comparative purposes, because in the latter part, I will be discussing with the benchmarking. There, this is very essential part, comparative purposes. The second is that it facilitates the assessment and evaluation of institutional operations, how the institute is working, the overall performance of the institute, how it is going on. This is in terms of in measurable terms. Then it also helps to external agencies for quality assurance audit of the institution. This is, as you can say, NAC or NIRF. They can assess us through this performance indicator. Here is a list of performance indicators you can see. For example, the teaching ability, research and publication outputs, students' contact effort. So the length or the width of the box says the weightage of this particular performance indicator. Teaching ability having maximum performance, that weightage, followed by research and publication outputs. But few are there, suppose students' placement, community service, they have also weightage, but not as like as the teaching ability. And depending on accreditors to accreditors, these indicators may have different weightings. Say, for example, one of the world ranking organization, QS World Ranking, so they have academic peer review, 40% weightage, faculty student ratio, 20% weightage, citation for faculty, 20% weightage. So employer review, which is a part of the NIRF ranking, 10% weightage. It means that how the employers expect our student to be their employee. 1 to 10 scale, they used to grade it. So employers review, 10% weightage. International faculty, international students have 5% weightage. So depending on the organization, it may be different. Whatever, there are some areas from which we can get the best performance indicators. And this is what we say, key framework for best performance indicators. There are, you can see in the slide, there's a flow chart, then inputs and there are outputs. When you talk about inputs, these are human resources or funding or the other infrastructure facilities. So in the first case, we have institutional climate and systems. This is the first one, and it is one of the very vital point where we have teachers' quality to be justified, teaching environment to be created, facilities to be provided, curriculums to be developed, transparent funding to be initiated. All these are there that create the total climate of the institute. And this gives this creates a student retention perception. Means more and more students may prefer our institute if we have these facilities, teachers' quality, teaching environment, facility, curriculums, all these are visible to all of them. And in many cases, while assessing the first one, the institutional climate, one criteria is very common in all of the accreditors, that is teacher-student ratio. And that is every time, every year, there are organizations, they assess this part, where you can see in 2017, for example, Norway is having 9:1, one of the best education system in Norway. They have 9:1 ratio. And if you come down to India, on the left side, you can see the ratio, it is public funded. You can see the green color is public funded, which is around 40:1. Not only 2017, the same study was done in 2019 by another organization. Here it is 25:1. So we are still struggling with the teachers in ratio. Means the first part, the institutional climate, we are still lagging behind. The second part is the diversity. How do we address different diversity of the society, the different sections of society, socioeconomically, the differences, the learning approaches, weak students, the better students, the faculty's recruitment, different categories of the students, admission. So in all these areas, how we maintain the diversity. And this reflects the institute's vision to maintain equality, commitment, and acquiring quality, improving quality in all sectors, irrespective of the differences. Mm-hmm. Then you come to the engagement and learning outcomes. This is one of the vital part because all the previous two areas, when we pass through, here we have to establish, prove that we are doing the best. There, we invite students for community engagement, the employment, extension work, academic, cultural, sports, how they participate, progression, studying abroad, qualifying different examination, national, international. So this engagement, along with the objective of the institute, is a vital part we need to prove. Because it is the part that after that they are going to the society. Then here they learn integrative learning, cross-cultural competencies, equity mindset they develop. So this part we have to address. And finally, before going to the last part, this is one way in Australia, from Australia, this example. There is a national survey they used to do every year for different students, first year, seniors, mid-year, whatever. So to understand, to get what is called feedback from the students, how they are, how they're engaged, how they're being helped by the faculties or the academic communities. We have to go for feedback system, but hardly we follow all these. But where the education system is very much advanced, they in an organized way, on a national level, they run this kind of feedback system. And the last one is the outcome, the achievements. You can see if we can perform better in all these three areas, so different performance indicators, we'll get a number, good number of application. We may get good rankings, faculty, we may have good public perceptions, alumni, resource mobilization, all these will come.
Dr. Surya Kumar Saikia.
Yes, and this is how the outputs are coming up. Now, these are performance indicators.
Let's
After, you know, switch on the mic, please. Hello. Okay. So now question is, after this performance indicator, yes, this is the benchmarking. Benchmarking means it is a process through which one institute can compare with some better institute, either in one aspect or maybe many aspects in relation to the objectives. So benchmarking, how does it help us? Here you can see there's a leading institute. So which is a better institute performing, the institute performing better than us, that is the leading institute. And the institute being evaluated is the my institute, for example. And while doing going for benchmarking attempts, we'll find at a particular point, there may be a gap. The gap comes due to some differences. So that is the quality of the leading institute better, and my institute is not performing better as for the leading institute. So at this point, some recommendations can be met and best practices can be adopted so that the evaluating institute can improve its quality. You know what is this Xerox, the machine that we have, we handle. In 1970s, this company was at loss. So this is the company, they first adopted the benchmarking process as a tool for improving their quality. For 10 years, they did benchmarking with different better companies. And you know what is the position of this Xerox company nowadays. So benchmarking is a part of which the institutes can improve the quality. If you come to the higher education institute, say for U1 is my institute, means I have to compare my institute with some other higher quality institute, U2, U3, U4, etc. And those accreditors, they treat all the institute as a student. Say for in the classroom, we compare, we ask questions to the students, and we classify which is the better students, which are the mediocre, which is the slow learners, depending on their responses. And we try to understand, we compare the slow learners with the better students to understand how far they are lagging behind. Similarly, the accreditors also do the same procedure here in case of benchmarking. So benchmarking gives us three benefits. First one is introspection. We can introspect ourselves where we are lagging behind, what are the processes we need to improve, or how to collect information to assess ourselves. So this is how the benchmarking gives the first instance. The second, many times we don't want to change ourselves. So benchmarking gives the foundation that helps us to overcome resistance to change. We are open to external evaluation and we accept the suggestions to change ourselves. And third one is the biggest one, that it lays the foundation for improvised quality management of the institute. So that is why it is one of the best essential part of quality evaluation of higher education. Now, how to do this? Because institution has to learn by itself. How does it learn? It learns from its faculties. The faculty learns from their learners. The similarity both way mechanism. So every time the institute learns by itself, benchmarking helps the self-learning, means we are going for self-examination. And while examining, we are adapting something to improve our performances. And what are those? The best practices. And at the same time, we are trying to find the areas where we need the improvements. So this process is continuous and cyclic. And this can be done at different levels, internal level, generic level, functional level, and competitive level. And also on a time scale, every year, at an interval of 5 years or continuous. There are 6 questions we need to ask while doing benchmarking. first one is, how well are we doing compared to others? This is the first question. And second is, how good do we want to be? The gaps we need to find out. Who is doing the best? We need to find a model institute or someone model with whom we can follow. How do they do it? That is, they also have to find out. How can we adapt what they do to our institution? So we have to be open that what they're doing, we should be able to adapt that one. And finally, the actual objective is, how can we be better than the best? So taking the example of NIR flanking of Vishwavarti, I want just to address the first question, how well are we doing compared to others? You can see here, in the first figure, 2017 to 2020, there are three institutes I am putting here. One is JNU, CU Mains, Calcutta University, and VVU. King George Medical University, I have put, this is a different issue, I will come later. But for the first instance, JNU, CU, and VVU, these three institutes I have put here. You can see the VVU is represented in blue color, and Calcutta University is a gray color, orange color. Color is changed. Okay. This is orange.
Yeah, it's okay.
It looks orange color here, but I don't know how does it look in the screen. So orange, Calcutta is orange color and the blue color, they started from the same point. But in 2018, you can see that gap. The gap I referred in the benchmarking, that first slide, the gap is there. So in 2018, we have not observed this gap. As a result, orange colored card has gone up in 2019, ranking 5, and 2020 it is 7. Whereas the blue colored curve has come down to 50. Because what is missing here? There is no recommendation in 2018 to improve this graph. So that is why this is one way, how well are we doing compared to others? We are not doing better or good compared to our very close competitor, the orange colored curve. JNU, obviously, it is a very fixed position, that flat curve is all the time above these two curves. Now coming to the next portion, how good do we want to be? And for this, I have compared all the different parameters that are used in NIR. You can see in the first case, this is the this is orange color curve and this is gray color curve, and these two curves are almost more or less similar at par in 2020 for the TLR, teaching learning resources. But in this parameter, which is graduating outcomes, you can see this gray color curve is below these two curves and the orange color curve. Here also the same situation, and in this case also the outreach and inclusivity also same situation. And perception also similar solution. So it is wrong that only perception affecting an institute. We are far behind in all these four areas, except the TLR in NIR ranking, while evaluating NIR ranking in 18, 19, and 20. And in the third case, who is doing the best? How to find this? These are the different parameters on which the NIR rankings are counted, student strength or examination, university examinations, perception, etc. Here you can see in 2019, JNU ranked 2, CU ranked 5, VBU 37, and King George Medical College 35. These are almost close to each other. And where this gray colored institute, this VBU, is lagging behind from these two leading institutes, there are around 10 areas. This red colored arrow marks, you can see 10 areas are there our institute is lagging behind those two institutes. And King George Medical College, being the perception is very low here in the peer, last graph you can see the cycle, peer still 35, it is ahead of this gray color institute. Whereas this, we are losing here in case of GUE. So these 10 areas were there where we lagging behind medicine to the great King George Medical College also. Although they are low perception, they have got better position than the Greek College Institute. Then in 2020, the JNU got second, CU 7, VDU 50, and King George Medical College 32. Here, the Greek College Institute has adjusted two parameters. Which are those parameters? These two parameters. One is that the general university examination, they have, you can see it was low, they have increased it. And perception also, it was very low. Now somehow they have recovered it to some extent. So with these two, they try to make up, but still they rank 50. Whereas the King George Medical College, which was very close to the Gray Color Institute, it excelled in three areas. You can see these three areas it excelled, and there they got rank 32. So how it happens? How it happens? Even though we compare benchmarking among the institute, this is a question to us whether even though improving the qualities, the institute in question has gone down to 50. Yes, we need to go for particular parameter wise analysis. In IPR, you can see the institute is still zero. The institute equation is still zero. And if we come down to benchmarking within the institute, there are six areas, there is no change. These are shown in the box in these 2 years. And had there been an effort to improve these areas by 0.3, how the score will change, would have changed. You can see 2019, our rank was 37. Had there been added 2 to the score, actually the score, it would have been 29. 2020, our score was 50. Had there been 2 added to the total score, our rank was 50. Had there been added 2 to the total score, our rank would have been 38. But since we don't have an analytical viewpoint, while this benchmarking effort during this time, we have lost those opportunities. So benchmarking at the national level, at the institution level, and within the institute, we have learned. And there is another part where we need to think about, that is benchmarking at international level. That helps because we need to increase the reputation, the perception in NIF ranking. How does it help? We need to open up to the international communities. It helps in learning, earning reputation. Then also it helps us to understand the international standards of our institute. And as I told in the beginning, we need to go for internationalization. How the policies can be taken up for this, it will help us. And these benchmarking efforts give international students a choice to come to our institute. How to do that? There are a number of different agencies, very well-known agencies. Those can help us benchmarking at international level. And two of them is, you know, the 2009 Times Higher Education World University Ranking, and second is QS World University Ranking. There you can see in Times World University Ranking, our university in most of the universities they can participate in this ranking because the criteria is very soft. In last 5 years, they need 1,000 publications to be there with the institute. And whereas, for example, our institute has 2,000, more than 2,000 publications, and the institute has to teach undergraduates. We have, and they have to work across a range of subjects. We have more than 300 subjects in our school. We can easily participate here. Here is an example how the international participation of this international ranking help us in the NIF ranking. You can see there are three institutes in 2 years. There is one, suppose Savitribai Phule Pune University, Amrita Vishwa Vidyapitham, Banarasi University. Their rankings were 10, 8, and 3 in during 2019. And they have scored almost more or less equal position rank in the Times World University ranking. What happened in 2020? Can Savitribai Phule, it has got one rank upgraded. Banarasi University retained its own rank. And you know, Amrita Vishwa Vidyapitham, it was 8 in 19 and got 4 in 2020. That is the benefit they're getting for through participation in the World University Ranking. And not only that, this Times World University Ranking has also another part, SCA University Ranking. And they also, other universities, as I told you, and everything they have improved. You can Jadavpur University here, I want to add. This is 144, which was 6 in 2019. And 2020, the impact came as 5 in NR ranking 2020. So this is how we can see those institutes, they are participating in the world ranking, they are getting benefit of ranking in NIRF. Another world university ranking organization is QS, Cockerelli Simmons Limited. Here, I have put University of Delhi, University of Hyderabad, and Jadavpur University. In 2019, they have got the rankings more or less equal, except University of Hyderabad. Now, University of Delhi, it was 13. And what happened in 2020? It is now 11. And Hyderabad was 4. But what happened in 2020? It is 6. You can see the ranking in the QS ranking also. 591 to 600, they have got 1001 plus. So there is a fall in the university ranking, that world ranking, and accordingly there's a fall in the NIRF ranking. So this is how we can see that somehow there's a relationship between the university ranking and the NIRF ranking. The benchmarking at universal level help us to understand how we are moving in NIRF ranking. And this is the best global university ranking. You know, this is mainly on research criteria, not on the students' perception, not on the engagement, mainly on research. So there it is, I'm very happy to tell you that Vishwabharati scored 756, the ranking, which is above Jadavpur University and University of Calcutta. I'm not telling these universities are very low than Vishwabharati, but so far research part is concerned, University of Vishwabharati is far better than those institutes. Even there are some other institutes. JNU is 1020, JMI is 999, BHU 856, of course, DU is 5564, ISC Bangalore is 520. And coming down to ranking web of universities, this is important because in most of the cases, informations are shared through the websites. The way we are available in the websites, the people from outside our country, they share the information from those resources. So this ranking is based on how we are available over net. You know, Ashraf, Majestic, these are the different kind of source of the information. Where from? Wherever we click Google, anybody is clicking Google, how many times they click Google, Ashraf and Majestic will note it and they will supply to the accreditors. And you can see top cited researchers, the Google Scholar, top cited papers, Simago. So all these we need to have. Otherwise, here also at the visibility is of our is very low, of any institute very low. And Vishwabharati in 2021 is 3223 in world ranking and 141 in India ranking, in ranking web of universities. Of course, there are more this type of ranking, but all cannot be, we cannot participate in all these kind of rankings unless we excel at very high quality production. So for in case of this ARWU, you can see we should have a Nobel Prize and field medals. We should have publications in Nature and Science. So it is difficult to participate in these cases. Even though we can attend others which are available to us, our criteria is matching to. But question is, are you ready for that? Are we ready for timely quality audit, or we are sleeping, or are there any internal benchmarking effort we have made in the last few years? Any university which are at lower part of the NIRNC normal? Or are we ready for world ranking? Which world ranking assessors to adopt? Who will lead the quality estimate and preparedness? Most important question is how the quality managers work. Are they working as a team or are they working as a single leader? So if we cannot answer this question, better to think that miles to go for better to achieve better quality. Thank you. Thank you,
Shujo, for this, shall I say, a wake-up call, a reality check, ground reality check. Now, your presentation carries a bit more weight simply because you've been looking into the Vishwabharati NAC preparations for the last two and a half years. So the data that you have put forward actually sort of makes us think on three lines. One, to what extent will the future of higher academics depend upon us ranking in all these frameworks that you were talking about? Two, can there be one singular position whereby these ranks could be sort of, these margins and the rankings from so many positions could be sort of regularized and made clear under certain parameters? Because in one parameter, we are 50th, on some other parameter, we are 60th. That is the second point. And third point, what needs to be done? Okay, so we are now opening up this discussion to questions and answers if need be. There's just one question that's come in from Aruna Dattagupta. Thank you for that attractive and lucid presentation. I have two queries. Is it possible that an intensely comparatist approach to quality assessment and control carries the danger of homogenization? Secondly, given the priority you rightly attach to teaching and mentoring students, do you see the possibility of a conflict with research interest? After all, if research and teaching have to progress in tandem, teaching must be specialized. Yet the increasing lateral spread of the cafeteria system ends up promoting a kind of buyer-seller equation between students and teachers. So, Shujo, would you like to sort of react to Anunna's query?
No, question is too long, but
take it one by one. Take the first part, the second part, and the third part, because there's no other question as such.
Can you repeat the first part?
First part is it possible that an intensely comparatist approach to quality assessment and control carries the danger of homogenization?
No, actually the problem is that it is what I wanted to deliver here, that homogenization, that is a challenge that on the first part I told you, these are all relative terms. But even though, that is why we have a number of agencies, otherwise one agency would have been better. And that is why we have to score the rankings from different agencies. And that differentiate us from that you can say we are stop us from going to homogenization. In one sector, if we are focusing on teaching learning, another sector we are focusing on research. So that way it is divided. I think that will be the best answer. Shuddha.
Thank you, Shujo. Are there any more questions, observations, comments? Anybody would like to?
Shudabda, this is Rakesh.
Yes, Rakesh, please go ahead. Yeah, ask
Shudabda. So this is a big platform because our Honorable Vice Chancellor is also there in this platform. So this is the best platform, I think, to discuss on the academic things of our university so that we can improve in a way so that we can rank, we can get a kind of high ranking in NIRF and also globally. So how we can achieve that actually?
Dr. Kundu, good question. Actually, that is
like incentive driven, like somebody got some project. So if our university may give him a kind of another room and other kinds of facility so that the teachers may encourage, may boost up, so that the other teachers who are not actually driving to those things, they are also maybe encouraged by our university's effort. So yeah, the academic support, I'm actually...
That is what we need to have, because administration and other academic these areas should work in a very harmonically. And that is what the objective, you know, that if you go to the Indian accreditors, the NAC and NRF, they look after all these things. But it is not always true that if you are from the academic effort also, even though there are some administrative support, we need to have more effort from the academics, because practically, since I am doing all these things for a few months, I understand that the academic contributions are more rigorously analyzed than the administrative core points. So administration is a supporting a player in academic improvement. So if there is no effort from academicians, then administration cannot help. So this is this point we have to look into before going to compare these two things as equal, academic and administration. And I think that is the best we have to keep.
Thank you, Shujo. There's a longish question, series of questions from Terence, from the Department of Philosophy, Terence Samuel. I've been following questions and comments. I would like to hear your answers. Question one, all through the presentation, I find that the quantity and numbers are confused with quality, but the problem is whether quantity reflects quality or should there be a different methodology to define quality? Shujo.
Yes, that is very important question, because that is why I told the first part of the talk that we are not defining quality in terms of some philosophical words. When you come down to quality of an higher education institute, it should be visible, countable. The what is called the book I told about what the hell is quality? The question. The answer is that if I have some employability as an outcome, how many students have got employment? That number gives the quality. I should not define what is employability. My question is give the numbers.
Because we are working with the system where our players are learners. We cannot put a philosophical term on them. If my objective of my program is developing some skill, the learner, when it goes out, he should be able to perform that skill. So that count should be there. It is there's a difference. But the question came. There's a difference. And here,
that is judged by the accreditors. How we are delivering the quality in measurable terms. There's a difference. That is there I want to emphasize. I have emphasized in this particular presentation.
Thank you, Shuju. The second part of Terence's question also ties up with Anunna's. In the first part of the lecture, you mentioned that quality is relative. If so, whether standardization could really reflect the quality, keeping in mind the regional cultural diversities of human population. Can we advocate a single system to evaluate the quality of education institutions?
Yeah. If the question is like that, if I understand the question, whether the quality assessment is addressing the local diversity, cultural diversity, is it suitable? It means the homogenization.
Somewhat. Yeah, very close to homogenization and standardization of the parameters which define, you know, positions in the rankings. Yeah, good, that, bad, ugly. Yes.
Yeah, there is a diversity option. That is why the key framework is there for best performance indicators. Even if you see the NIRF criteria, there is a regional diversity. You know, all these things cannot be put total, and they cannot be put exactly on the quantifiable criteria. But even though there are options, when you talk about we see from which different categories students are coming, or we can see from outside the state or inside the state, outside the country, how they are coming. This way, the regional diversity are placed. And I'm a little bit confused about cultural diversity, but these cultural diversities are coming through, you know, curriculums. We cannot put on a tag. These are coming through curriculums.
Thank you, Shuju. The third and final part of Samuel's observation is you talked about accountability. To whom the education should be accountable, whether the accountability might compromise the ideals of education like reflective praxis as conceived by idealists. How do you respond to this?
So education is finally for society. Although we have, as I told you, that we have a number of stakeholders, we have a fund from a particular organization to run my institute, I should fulfill their objectives first. But overall, above all this, whether my funder is having or not, funder also having the same objective to serve the society. That is why they're giving us fund. And that is why overall objective, we are accountable to the society. If we are not having deliverables, if we cannot deliver our learners in a very skillful way, as part of the objective of our institute, of the society the way they need, we are not, it means we are not accountable. We are not doing something wrong. So finally, we are accountable to the society.
Thank you, Shujo. The question from next question is from Shubhashree Shannal from Social Work. This is slightly technical because she has always been part of the NAC, and so the question is very much related to what we have been working on and how Bishwa Bharati stands up with reference to other universities in India and abroad. This is, given the blended approach to education, how do you see the learning outcomes based curriculum framework of which we have just implemented the first bit in 2017. So if it is the blended approach to education, you're talking about homogenization, you're talking about standardization and rationalization, how do you sort of incorporate all these with reference to the movement towards the new educational policy that's going to come up, national educational policy that's moving towards the cafeteria system? How do we justify this? And far more important, how do we as a university look forward to taking this transition, if at all?
Yeah, you know, that as I told you, that the increasing number of students, the global level, it is similar case at national level also, the number of students are increasing. And one of the objectives of this new education policy is to increase the number of enrollment to 50%. Now it is 26.3. At this moment, and our new education policy has an objective to increase it up to 50%, and there lies everything, because the all these outcomes, and you know, we are in a transition, because this new education policy has so much of given so much of options, and there are some areas of new education policy still not clear, but it is. I have gone through the new education policy. It is written an organization to be set, but those particular organizations, the objectives are not yet fully written. So we have to wait for that. But even though there are some corners where it is written very clearly that it is emphasizing on skill, and this is the first objective of new education policy. Means we are marching to skill and knowledge base. These two are the outcomes. They are those that Dr. Shubhashree told, the curriculum, outcome-based curriculum. We need to classify, clarify what are the skills. And that is a step, I say, better. And this is going to be changed. It should be very, very clear. Our clarity should be there that my course is this, having this kind of skill, this kind of knowledge that can be tested. So we have to wait for some time. I think we have to wait for few more time for this one.
Shudipta, can I add something, please, if you don't mind?
Yeah, please go ahead.
I had a query, because the discussion is so interesting, I couldn't stop myself. The thing is, you know, how do we assess quality? You know, because UGC has certain benchmarks, like you have to complete these many hours of classes, these many academic publications, these many seminars and lectures, these many scholars. So if you actually rationalize it, I mean, some or the other arena is bound to take over the other. So somebody might focus more on attending conferences, somebody might focus more on doing papers, and then classroom teaching might be severely hampered. And again, classroom teaching, we know, is not the only parameter for a teacher. There's also your publications, your writings, your journals, your lectures, everything counts. So what happens in this blended approach also, I mean to say, because we are again talking about indigenous, going back to the community and learning, do we not think that the earlier method of classroom teaching, that is the direct pedagogical learning, which nowadays obviously is not possible because of coronavirus, but somewhere don't you feel as an academician that the classroom teaching is severely suffering because of the academician's huge pressure to perform in terms of publications or doing seminars, lectures, you know, making your presence felt is basically the word, you know, otherwise you are not a teacher enough, maybe. So I don't know, this is a common thought that is occurring to me for the last few months, that is are these all criteria need to be fulfilled by one person, because after all, everybody doesn't have the same maybe not be good in all the aspects, we are not jack of all trades. So I just wanted your opinion on it, that is this the way to go forward? I mean, how do we assess quality, you know, somewhere drawing from a little bit on what is, why, how do we quantify quality, you know? We are trying to quantify quality.
Yes, Lucy, I could not hear in between, but so far you are talking about we have to go forward in a FPS. Okay, quality, because you are talking about the faculty concern, you know, the accreditors also, they are many times, they are changing the patterns, they are changing the indicators. So that when they come out with a set of indicators, the next two years or 3 years, they change the indicators. They understand that there is a mistake. And that is why, you know, 2016, that API, the indicators, there are 4 amendments. How do you believe that within the 10 to 16, the 6 years, 4 amendments come. And 2018, everything changed, there is a new FPI scoring pattern. So it means that the quality assessment is always in a changing pattern. I told you that in the presentation, the countable is necessary, because without any measuring some parameters, you cannot put something on abstract line. So when there is competition, we put some figures, either some scales or some ranges we have to put. So somehow these things are being tried to put on a scale. And there, every time there is an experiment going on. We don't know. So we have to bear this one.
So Devda, this is Patho. Can I ask a question?
Oh, just 1 minute, Patho. We can see our honorable vice chancellor listening from his desk. Sir, would you like to sort of come in and sort of react or respond to this?
I think my request to you that please exhaust all the questions being asked to Shurjo, and then probably as a kind of summary remark, I'll come at the end and just summarize, and then I'll make my observations. Is that okay?
Yes, sir, that's fine. That's absolutely fine, sir. So, Partho, could you come up with your question then, Partho Pratip?
Okay, Shujada, thank you very much. Shujada, this is Parthoda. No. Okay, since I know that today your focus is on higher education, but I know since you have been a school teacher, let me take the focus towards that also, because Viswabharati has its own unique structure from KG to PG. Now, I was just curious to know whether does it lend any sort of importance into your purview of quality in education? Since I know that you were talking about higher education, but you know, education is education after all. I was just curious to know that, would you like to include the school sections of Viswabharati when you judge Viswabharati in its wholeness and variety? Thank you.
Pardon that, very good question. Now, these activities don't have the space, but no, there is a part. You know, I told you that if we want to meet the different corners of the institutes, the improvements, we have to take some best practices. And this school part, we have coming under best practices. This is a distinctiveness of the institute that we are growing up, nurturing these students with a particular philosophy and philosophical arena. And they are contributing to the institute's the continuity of the mission and vision. So that part we can cover, and you'll be happy that this part is one of the best part of the institute. If we talk about in terms of Vishwabharati, that is the distinctiveness of the institute. One distinctiveness. That way we can edit.
Sudev, can I ask some question?
Yes, Shantaruda, please go ahead.
So thank you, Surjo, for this a nice topic. And I'm thankful to the organizer and Surjo also for choosing this particular topic. And one thing I can mention that, so this is a continuation of the question of Subhasri. Actually, the quality of the education is depending upon many things. That's why there are different organizations, they actually ranking the universities in the world or in India also. And they give emphasis to certain criteria. Some other organization, they give some other criteria. That's why the ranking differs from different, by different organization. Whenever they put the ranking differs. So for our case, if we're really actually interested for the ranking regarding the quality of the education and the national organization, those who are doing all these things, that is NAC, or NIRF. So in that case, I think so we have to rather identify the areas, the criteria where the rankings are made. And these organizations that adopting these criteria and they are making the rank. So in that case, we have to emphasize particular these criteria to develop, how to develop it. I think that should be our motto for better ranking of the university. That's all about. Thank you, Surjo, again.
Yeah, Shantanu sir. Yeah. Actually, the presentation that I have given, it is not on ranking. It is on the improvement of the quality. And we don't understand how we are improving our quality. We don't understand. If we go, if we just perform our duties and we try to fulfill different needs of the institute, we can't understand. That is why we need ranking on that perspective. But to get ranking, if we do, that is a wrong question.
Okay, right? Thank you.
Shujo, there's this question from Joydeep Mondol. Please narrow down the area/field where Vishwabharati should work in the future to secure higher rank. What is your position regarding this?
Yes, Vishwabharati needs teamwork. That is narrowed down. I have narrowed down. Okay, Vishwabharati needs teamwork. And it's a team already.
Teamwork. Okay. So another question from Professor Sudhanshu Shekhar Maiti. In regards to NIRF, do you think to set benchmark when there almost is no mark in IPR and consultancy project for Vishwabharati? In respect to Professor Maiti's response, may I also add something that you and I are already aware of? That in 2020, Vishwabharati scored 50, whereas Delhi University stood at number 10. But under teaching, learning, and research, Vishwabharati had scored 58%, whereas Delhi University had just scored 50%. So we had an edge over Delhi University in the primary research and learning and teaching, but we are lagging behind the other infrastructural point of view. And I think Professor Maiti's position is also borne out by this fact that there is no mark in IPR and consultancy project for Vishwabharati. So how do you respond to this?
Sridhar, what we are talking about Delhi University and Vishwabharati, actually this is teaching learning resource, that's a particular parameter. No, I have shown you the graph that this particular parameter is at par with the JNU, with the Calcutta University, and also you have told this is Delhi University. But if you go for other four criteria, we are far below than those universities. There we need a consultant. And regarding Professor Maiti's question, query, I should say, we are just participating in NIRF. We are not trying to analyze why we are going down. Had there been some benchmarking in 2018, 17, 19, we could have improved those particular areas. Say, for example, you can see the economically social, economic and socially backward sector. There we had not improved in 2019 and 20. But this part is very easier to improve. We need to open up for fellowships given by different institutes. We have to show them the fellowships are invited, and that we can easily add. Second is that physically intersection, we have not improved in that parameter in the NIRA. You know, that is very easier. We are writing every time that we have 50%, we have ramps, but we can, this is hardly, we need 10 lakh rupees to add ramps in all the departments and all the offices. We can rate around 100%. So had there been any analysis at the time, these particular points could have been improved. That is what we need. What I want to convey that we should have some benchmarking every time we are going down at NIRA ranking. And that is why I need, there should be a teamwork we need, but there should be some analysts, there should be some policymakers, there should be some strategists, all people are there. It is not one man show. That there I need to emphasize.
Thank you, Shujo. I think we have no more questions as such. So would the Honorable Vice Chancellor come in here and sort of add or respond to what we've been talking about? Or, sir, would you like to join us?
Sudeep, thank you. Shurjo, thanks a lot. Shurjo, let me begin by appreciating you, because it's a difficult job to continue talking for about an hour on a particular theme. Now, but I have my opinion, which may go contrary to yours, because I didn't find anything so exciting to talk about. I mean, I'm sorry, I'm using little, you know, stronger words, simply because you have a long way to go. And you have a lot of responsibility to shoulder. Given all these things, I'll be little, you know, strong in my comments. Of course, on the basis of my own understanding, and also I try to persuade my colleagues and also pursue my argument by reference to certain, you know, specific evidence. You know, first of all, you know, I'll begin with two important, interesting anecdotes that were talked about in the Constituent Assembly debates. You know, when the Constitution was being talked about, or the Constitution was being set out, in which all the members participated, you know, there was a debate, you know, long debate between the Gandhians and those who are more or less blind supporter of the Western Enlightenment tradition. And one of the points the Gandhians made, and especially the representative of the Gandhians was K. Hanumantayya from Andhra Pradesh. He said that we have come here to listen to Veena and Sitar, but unfortunately we are hearing British band. That's the first anecdote. And the second anecdote is that when you talk about the Constitution, the Gandhians made the same statement. You know, somebody from Bengal, Kashikanto Moitro, he made the statement that when we are talking about the Constitution, we hardly talked about our own reality, and to frame the views, to frame the provisions with reference to our own experiences. You know, I'm making these two statements in conjunction with my argument, namely that the entire discussion which you have really produced or presented in a very immaculate fashion is based on derivative knowledge. You know, I mean, somehow or the other, I have the impression that intellectually we are actually servile, or we are subservient to the point of view given either by the MHRD or the UGC, or, you know, somewhere from the West, because the criteria which we have evolved so far while assessing the Institute of Higher Education are mostly derivative. You know, there is no doubt about it. So I think, you know, I will always keep raising question on that. But whether that question is valid or not, that's a different thing. That's my point of view. Secondly, I think, I think somebody talked about school education. I think that's not a very valid kind of criticism, because if I just looked at the title of Shurjo's presentation, it's about the quality of higher education. So I'll just focus on higher education, leaving school education behind. And I think I see the point of my colleague that Vishwabharati is perhaps one of those two universities in the country which has school education as integral to the system of higher education here that we pursue in Vishwabharati. I'm really sorry to Shurjo that if you had an attention to what Rabindranath Tagore wrote in Tota Kahini, the story of a parrot, Tota Kahini, then probably you would have come up with some original ideas regarding the quality of higher education in India. Now, if you, those who remember Tota Kahini's story, it's very short, very about, I think, 4 pages story, that the king wanted Tota, the parrot, to learn, to be educated. So the king hired the pandits, and the pandits wanted to push all kinds of, you know, the papers in which he wrote the powerful verses of the Vedas and Upanishads, and then put it inside the Tota's, you know, belly. And after a while, the Tota died, and when it was found out that his belly was full of papers. So, you know, from this Tagore derived that the sort of education which we derive or which we get in India is nothing but the attempt of the pandits just to push all those, you know, papers into our, you know, stomach. And we don't really care whether the education or whether the ideas are really properly digested or not. So I think, you know, this is something which we should keep it in mind. And if you want to know more about it, Rabindranath Tagore spoke extensively on these issues in his famous speech called Chhatrode Proti Sambhashan. It's in Bengali. Now, you know, I'm just referring to all these ideas so that we can be innovative in our ideas. And you know, some of them referred to, two important questions. I think one came from Rakesh, another came from Terence. I mean, I just would like to refer to those two questions simply because, you know, Rakesh, you know, I understand that, you know, when someone, my colleagues get a project, he or she requires space, understandable. But, you know, have you ever thought about the misuse of the facilities which we get by virtue of being part of Vishwabharati? Because, you know, I mean, again, you know, probably you will not like my way of, you know, saying all these things, because when I came, I was told by somebody that the Vishwabharati is nothing but a commuting university. And here teachers come by Ganadevota and leave by Shantiniketan Express, and while leaving, they buy fish from Lakhopati. Now, if that is the kind of an accountability of our teachers, then I think, you know, whatever discussion you make, Shurjo, and whatever discussion we have involving so many of our colleagues, it makes no sense. It's futile. So I think Terence raised the question of accountability, I just would like to bring to his notice that, you know, that his department, you know, most of the colleagues decided not to come. I mean, the question is that, you know, they didn't have internet connection, so they decided to leave. And then I installed the internet connection and the computer. But still, I am told that some of the colleagues, you know, continue to maintain that, you know, old habits. Now, if that happens, then, you know, accountability, the question of accountability. I mean, who do you really put as a kind of, you know, culprit in this case? Because if we do not use whatever facilities we have got, you know, why should we ask for room when one gets a project? Why should we ask for facilities when you get a project? I know I'm not blaming everybody. Don't misunderstand me. I'm not blaming everybody. But somehow or the other, that's the pattern we follow. So I think when you think of accountability, my first accountability is to the society. Now, you know, I think I feel ashamed. I'm sure most of my colleagues feel like me when we get the salary. You know, the salary is a kind of hefty sum, and we get this hefty sum in a country where even today, as far as Niti Aayog is concerned, 34% of our people live below poverty line. It means that 34% of our people do not get two proper meals a day. Now, if that's the situation, and keeping that in mind, I mean, the sort of salary, the sort of comfort, and the sort of, you know, kind of popularity which you gain is, you know, really abysmally high. So I think, you know, when you think of accountability, I just would like to request all my colleagues to introspect. Now, then the third question comes, higher education. Now, you know, here I think I request my colleagues to read the German system of higher education. Now, in India, if you have nothing to do, you go for higher education. And I'll tell you an interesting experience of mine. A student of mine took 5 years to finish his MPhil. So I asked him I just called him, and he came to my office. And I told him, how do you explain this, you know, huge delay? Then he said a very interesting kind of expression in Hindi, sir, UPSC ka mahima. So that means, you know, his first priority was to go for UPSC, to become an IAS or a collectorate. And since he failed there, that's why he came for MPhil and then a PhD. And of course, you know, he got a job in a college in Delhi University. So if that's your priority, I think then, how will you expect that he or she will give the best to the higher education? You know, again, I'm not generalizing. You know, don't please misunderstand me. I'm not generalizing. Some of my colleagues are brilliant. Some of my colleagues are very attentive. Some of my colleagues, you know, very true to their duties. But, you know, there are some. And because of them, you know, in a bag of potato, if there are 4 rotten potatoes, you know, that can destroy the entire bag. So I'm just talking about those rotten potatoes. Now, so higher education to me is meant for those who are capable, and secondly, who are inclined. Now, unless and until you are capable and inclined, you are not meant to pursue higher education. But in India, I mean, unfortunately, higher education is meant for those who do not get a good placement anywhere else. I'm not saying that there are some who opted for higher education. I agree with that. But many of my colleagues all over the country I'm talking about, since you are younger than me, I've got, you know, more exposure than you. Many of our colleagues, you know, outside Vishwabharati, outside Bengal, you know, for them, the higher education is the probably the last better option. That's why they come here. So I think, to me, higher education needs to be restricted. And that's the second point I'd like to highlight. The third point, national education policy. You know, people are very critical of national education policy, you know, but when I read the document, and I also made presentation on this particular document, if you compare it with the Kothari report, 64, then 86, then 92, and then 2020. So if you, you know, take all of them, I think till 92, the education system in India was very much a derivative of the European mode of thinking, basically. You know, it is, I argue always that is the Macaulay's poison tree that he, you know, planted in 1835 that continued to influence our education till at least 1992, till the adoption of 2020 National Education Policy. As a result, our thinking gets clouded. You know, and even today, my son talks good English, I feel very proud. But, you know, I don't insist that you should speak in Bangla or you should speak in any other, you know, mother tongue, simply because the servility is being injected. You know, it's part of our blood. Servility is being injected over a period of time since the adoption of the Macaulay's minutes in 1835. And that continued till 2019. In fact, there are some agitation after 1992 education policy was adopted, that it was very much, you know, based on Western source of knowledges. You know, I have nothing against it. You know, I myself I myself, you know, I'm a product of the Western system of education, both here in India and abroad. But still, I think that when we apply those criteria or those parameters, you know, I don't really get the kind of result which I should have. So in that case, 2020 National Education Policy is actually a step towards attaining that. You know, don't forget the National Education Policy 2020 is not the kind of, you know, straight-jacketed model. It's a blueprint. It's a blueprint. It's a kind of, you know, a way forward. And it comprises guidelines. And on the basis of those guidelines, we can certainly, you know, talk about. I mean, somebody talked about the higher education is relative to these circumstances. National Education Policy is exactly talking about that. That, you know, higher education in the context of Bengal and higher education in the context of elsewhere, you know, they're likely to be different. Because, you know, Bengal, I mean, we have access to the English literature, books written in English, books written in our mother tongue. But, you know, think of Bihar, think of UP, think of, you know, remote areas of Rajasthan, think of remote areas of southern states. No, so I mean, the point I'm trying to make that do not mistake National Education Policy as the model. It is basically a guideline. It is basically a way forward. It is basically a blueprint. So keeping that in mind, I think we have great things to do. But at the same time, you know, I agree with a colleague of mine who talked about that when you assess Vishwa Bharati, it needs to be assessed differently. Because, you know, our Kala Bhavan, our Sangeet Bhavan, our Bhasha Bhavan, you know, especially Chinese and Hindi department, they are pretty well known. But, you know, science department may not be so with reference to, you know, the projects, with reference to the patents, with reference to the publication in high impact fed journal, which you find, say, elsewhere in JNU, in Delhi University, or Institute of Science Bangalore. But, you know, that should not be the criteria. Because, you know, Vishwa Bharati has its own way of looking at things. And I think we'll have to, you know, implore the UGC or the NAC that, you know, you cannot standardize the assessment criteria when you assess Vishwa Bharati. So I think I'm pretty confident that, you know, though we have done the NAC, we're waiting for the NAC to come, that we have to devise our own way of looking at things, not at the cost of the standard, because when you know do things, it should be at the global level. I mean, I'm not asking you to compromise that Vishwa Bharati has a standard, so we'll go for, you know, what is called texts or creative texts which are not comparable with that of the, you know, global standard. No, I'm not saying that. I'm simply saying that, you know, there are certain areas which need to be assessed differently. Simply because Vishwa Bharati is a unique kind of institution with a great legacy of Tagore. And I think the Tagore's understanding of education continues to remain valid even today. So I request Shurjo and those who are listening to this particular, you know, very interesting lecture by my young colleague, Dr. Shaikia, read Tagore extensively, then probably that will provoke you, you know, to get into new areas of, you know, knowledge, to quest for new dimensions of knowledge. So, and from that, then probably you can, you know, think of an original kind of, you know, way of looking at things. You know, I'm not saying that I have got all the answer. I'm simply giving you some idea as to how to reach a stage where you will think originally, where your thinking will not be restrained by derivative knowledge. I mean, this is something which we should keep it in mind. That's why I keep talking about it, that we should introspect very, very seriously. Are we, you know, doing things in terms of what we have received, or are we doing things in terms of what we think originally? I think if I were you, I would have gone for the latter, that, you know, we should think originally, and we should think in terms of the context, the milieu, the social milieu, in which we are born and nurtured and we survive. So I think, you know, if you take all of them into account, then probably we'll have a fresh outlook of higher education in India and how to improve higher education. I mean, we are really unfortunate compared to the West, even compared to Bangladesh. You know, gross enrollment ratio here, you know, it is so low, absolutely low, even compared to Bangladesh. So I think we should not, we don't think about that. We think about very, you know, higher grand ideas, but we do not think why a young kid of a village drop out. And, you know, I'm telling you my experience. I went to Uttar Pradesh, Amethi and Sultanpur, just to do a kind of, you know, survey studies on election about you know, I think four or five in 2019 Lok Sabha poll. And the, you know, I just asked about the young kids, and they told me that they go to school 4 days because they get, you know, either anda or chicken. And the rest of the 2 days they don't go because they don't get non-veg items. So, you know, here education is not important. What is important is the food. Now, that's an important issue. You know, if you want to really expand education, you need to take care of these basic needs. So I think, you know, higher education cannot be really insulated from the social, economic, and political reality. You know, you have to understand it in tandem with the social, economic, and political context. Only then probably we can think innovatively. So my Shurjo, you know, please don't misunderstand me. I'm simply trying to provoke you so that, you know, next time you come up with ideas which are very interesting, and probably we can, you know, contribute to the national education policy, because the national education policy is an open-ended document. You know, we can keep on adding to that. So I think, you know, Vishwabharati probably is one of the few universities in the country which has a great legacy, and we have got, you know, great ideas which we have got from our great, you know, illustrious son of India, Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. So, you know, if we just bring them in, and our own idea and the context, probably we'll be able to devise a very innovative, uniquely textured, you know, form of higher education. I mean, I'm interested in higher education because I'm part of the higher education, and school education is a different thing. Probably I can, you know, say things, but, you know, I'll refrain from saying all those things because I don't have any first-hand experience of school education. And I'd like to, you know, hear it from somebody with first-hand experience of school education. But overall, you know, overall, Shurjo, I'm very happy. I'm very provoked. And I'm sure my colleagues, those who listen to you, I can see the number is dwindling, is now 59. So I think, you know, I'm talking probably too much. So before all disappear, I think I must say namaskar to all of you, and please be safe. And Bipasha, I thank you for having organized this wonderful discussion. Sudev, for wonderfully conducting the question answers session. And Shubhasri for having introduced Shurjo in a very, very lucid manner. And all my colleagues who ask questions, I am thankful to all of you. And I'm very happy that this particular platform has taken off. I mean, the credit the Bipasha should share the credit with the rest of his colleagues. So I'm not giving credit entirely to Bipasha, but Bipasha, and along with his able and very interested colleagues who kept it going. And I'm sure in future, we'll have the privilege of listening to wonderful lectures as we did today by our very young, very energetic, and a very vibrant colleague, Dr. Shurjo Shaikya. Namaskar, bhalo thakben.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I'll keep you.
Thank you, sir. The credit goes to all my committee members. They have been working behind the scenes.
Happy Shurjo, kichu bolcho?
Keep your word, sir. Definitely, sir. Hello.
Shurjo, kichu bolcho tumi? আলো কম থাকে, চোনা বেশি থাকে, আমি আলোচনাটা চাই, মানে আলো আলো যেন থাকে, চোনা কম থাকে, বুঝতে পারছো? তো সেই আমার, আমি খুব পরিষ্কার বললাম, কারণ আমার মনে হয় যে রবীন্দ্রনাথ একটু পড়ো ভালো করে, জানো তো, রবীন্দ্রনাথটা পড়লে তুমি দেখবে ওই ছাত্রদের প্রতি সম্ভাষণ আর তোতা খাই না। আমি আমার পড়া খুবই অল্প সত্যি কথা বলতে গিয়ে, আমি দুটো পড়েছি। তারপর ওর একটা পাবনা স্পিচ আছে 1907, তারপর স্বদেশের সমাজ 1904, এবং কালাত্তরে বহু লেখা আছে, প্লাস বিশ্বভারতীর একটা বই আছে শান্তিনিকেতন তৈরি করলেন 1921 সালে, তখন লিখেছিলেন কেন বিশ্বভারতী। তো এইগুলো না পড়লে বোঝা যায় যে উনি একটা মানে ওনার ওনার আইডিয়াটা হয়তো মে নট বি রেলিভেন্ট নাও, আই এম নট সেইং দ্যাট ইউ হ্যাভ টু ইমিটেট দ্য আইডিয়াস হুইচ টেগোর টকড অ্যাবাউট ইন 1921, নো, বাট আই এম জাস্ট আস্কিং ইউ টু আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড দ্য মেথোডোলজি মেথোডোলজি টু অ্যারাইভ অ্যাট ইনোভেটিভ আইডিয়াস। তাহলে কিন্তু দেখবে এডুকেশন সম্বন্ধে কিন্তু অনেক নতুন আইডিয়াস কিন্তু ভাবনা চিন্তা আমরা করতে পারবো।
Thank you, sir, for your incisive and very involved intervention. We sort of look into this, and I think we also need to look into the national education policy. Bipashadi, should I wrap this up, or would anybody else like to sort of respond to this?
I think we could wrap this up. Thank you. I would like to thank sir for your kind comments, and all the credit goes to my committee members who are working behind the scene. And just one more point, sir, you added, you talked about Kalantar and Swadeshi Samaj. I'll just add Polli Prakriti to that. Thank you, sir.
আমাদের এরপরে কিন্তু 4 তারিখে বলছে সঞ্জয় কুমার, ও বলবে হাউ টু আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড ইলেকশন। এন্ড সঞ্জয় অ্যাজ ইউ নো হি ইজ দ্য ডিরেক্টর অফ লোকনীতি, যারা অল ইন্ডিয়া সার্ভে করে ফোরকাস্ট করে, হি ইজ দ্য ডিরেক্টর অ্যান্ড হি হ্যাপেন্স টু বি মাই স্টুডেন্ট অলসো। তারপরে সঞ্জয়ের পরে বলবে বদ্রীনারায়ণ, বদ্রীনারায়ণ হচ্ছে এলাহাবাদ ইউনিভার্সিটির অধ্যাপক, নাও ডিরেক্টর পান্থ ইনস্টিটিউট। হি উইল টক অ্যাবাউট দলিতস ইন ইউপি পলিটিক্স, দলিতের উপরে খুব ভালো ভালো কাজ আছে দেখো তুমি। তারপরে 22 তারিখে বলবে বব করোডনস্কি on CSR, corporate social responsibility. And then 23 tarike dhamaka, it will be addressed by Arvind Panagaria. So I think he will talk about, I think most probably contemporary economic scene. So I think the whole, full April is full, and we'll have opportunity to listen to some of the big and good minds. And I'm sure Bipasha also will will pitch in between, right? Bipasha, you have also some
Lectures in April. Amarendra Kumar and then Anunna. Anunna will talk. First Amarendra, then Anunna in April.
Kabe bolbo Amarendra?
History department. Sir, ওই ডেটটা আমরা মোটামুটি ফিক্স করছি আর্লি এপ্রিল, তবে ওই যাতে ওই ডেটস গুলো ক্ল্যাশ না করে ওটা উইথ দ্য হেল্প অফ নিমাইদা উইল ওয়ার্ক ইট আউট।
হ্যাঁ, 3 তারিখ, 13 তারিখ, 22 আর 23, তাই তো আমাদের নিমাই?
স্যার 7
ইলেকশন সম্বন্ধে কি বলে দেখি। ঠিক আছে তাহলে, থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ। আই কান্ট অফার ইউ টি, বাট আই ক্যান অফার ইউ টি ভার্চুয়ালি। ওই নিমাই খাওয়াই তো, নিমাই নিশ্চয় চা খাওয়াচ্ছে তোমাকে, সূর্য নিমাই নিশ্চয় চা খাইয়েছে। হ্যাঁ, নিমাই মিষ্টিও খাওয়া জানো তো, তোমাকে খাইয়েছে আমাদের, আমাকে কিশোর বললো অ্যাটেন্ড করলে মিষ্টি খাওয়াই নাকি, তুমি ঠিক করেছি ওখান থেকে অ্যাটেন্ড করবো।
হ্যাঁ আসুন, সূর্য চা খাওয়া কি
সেন্ট্রাল লাইব্রেরি, স্পেসিফিক্যালি ডক্টর নিমাই চাঁদ সাহা, Kaushik, who's also part of the committee for the dialogic. We'll, of course, keep everybody in the loop. We also have four, as Sir says, four lectures in April and two lectures from dialogic. So six lectures somewhere in April. And we'll keep everybody informed. We'll put this up on the website. So thank you for being with us. Thank you for your participation. And hope to see you again in the next, the fourth edition. Thank you, everyone.
Okay. Thank you, Shudev.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.